Don't try to sneak into your room like that. I know what you've got behind your back. Records. More new records.
Diamonds, and we have the new Krell KSA I-400, and we actually have the designer of that amp with us today as well. And we have the Krell Illusion preamp, the Inuus statement, and then the MSB reference DAC. And connecting all of the gear is the AudioQuest Dragon level cable.
Yep.
Hi there. How was last night? I'm sorry I missed it.
Last night was amazing. We got it on tape.
Are you playing it?
We caught it on tape. No, not yet. What we are doing right now is I've got two rock bands, local area rock bands. So they're going to present their music video, and then they're going to talk about the recording process and what they are doing.
Cool.
You can feel the heat emanating off of it. It's like a heater.
Look at this. Tubes galore below.
I know. That's where the heat's coming from. Okay. Yeah, that's where the heater is. Okay. Wow. I mean...
It's cool, isn't it? It's a cool...
Yeah, it is cool.
I mean, it's hot, but it's
cool.
It kind
of makes me wonder. I think that maybe instead of constantly, people constantly buying space heaters, they should just buy something like this.
Right.
Because it heats up the room and it sounds good.
And makes tunes. Right, exactly.
It's this bloated bass. Same with Heroes. They're all compressed. The space is sucked out. And then for when they got around to doing Lodger, they did a remix of Lodger because the original was just done on the board. And with little outboard gear. So it's a very simple mix. It's not the greatest, cleanest, most spacious mix on the original, but it's the original intent.
I can see that.
But the remix of it, Tony Visconti did the remix, drenched it in reverb. It is just soaking in reverb. But when they did the remaster original mix of Lodger, the original mix remastered was in the same box as the remix. So the original mix remastered, it's all muddy, probably because they wanted to sell the remix. If you compare the original, if you compare the original mix remastered versus an original UK or an original German pressing, it sucks.
Okay, well we'll live with it for a few minutes.
Hi there.
Hi. A young audiophile have the best ears in the industry.
Michael, I
probably
from the CES 2013.
Yeah.
Or we just talking?
Just talking otherwise.
Okay.
Okay, so this is the new Kuzma.
This is relatively new. It's been on the market for, I don't know, a few years. But he took once he did the Stogie S 12 with the VTI tower, which he reviewed on Analog Planet, he stretched this one and it's full 12 inches, has the same VTI offset tower and high quality ceramic, conventional bearings.
Right.
And this one just happens to come with the standard copper wire, the standard Cartus copper wire, not the fancy Cartus clear. And it's a Car 50 cartridge.
Right.
And this is very well played in, and it's just the whole system sounding really, really good.
And
I'm very impressed.
And this will fit into the same...
9-inch distance. And look, this one even came with a cut for SME, the old racetrack, for like Grandpa.
Sure, yep.
And so we used Kuzma's own SME adapter to get this in because I didn't have another arm board. There is one like this that doesn't have the VTA tower. That's a regular conventional 12-inch arm.
And then you can... Okay.
Yeah, it's somewhat less expensive.
And this is $6,000?
This was just over $6,000.
Wow, that's great.
And this Stabiar variant is a the standard silver color, removable arm board. And what's nifty now, if he drills the arm board for a standard Kuzma arm, you can put the 4.14 on by just taking the arm board and turning it around.
Yeah. Oh, cool.
He didn't figure that out at first, but then he made the modification.
What does that table cost?
This one right here is just over $10,000. You can get it in all sorts of crazy finishes for more money and such.
It's nice. That's
and
nice.
It comes in the walnut box one too. They're downstairs.
Yeah. Okay. Is that what's new?
That's what. Oh!
Oh, what?
Also, the new top of the line Furitech power cord called the Project V1 retails for $9,550. And I've never brought this, and that's brand new. I mean, it just came out. This has been on the market for some time. This is now the NCF version of their Pure Power 6 top of the line power distributor. Weighs like 22 pounds, it's all milled aluminum. It seems to be doing a nice job in making everything super dynamic, quiet, and clean.
Okay.
It's all snake oil, Scott.
Well, it kind of looks like a snake. No. But it's very dry. Did you know snakes are dry if you feel them?
Yes.
They're not oily at all.
Okay, that's what's new. I've got to keep moving.
All right, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
So let's see what we got here. This is your new cartridge with no impedance. I reviewed this, so I know what this is, and I know what this is. So this is like a current to voltage converter. It's not like a step up transformer. It's an actual current to voltage converter, so you can get a low internal impedance cartridge and turn your moving magnet phono preamp into a current transimpedance thing. So that's good. And then this speaker system. Okay. And what is the new cartridge called? The new cartridge is the...
C0.
C0.
But it's actually C0.1.
It better be something.
Right here.
And is that what we're hearing here? Is that what's...
No.
This is
this is a test sample.
They wouldn't let it into the country. It's too dangerous. All right, and so this puts out prodigious amounts of voltage from no internal impedance.
You mean current?
Current.
Yeah, prodigious amounts of current.
Hi there. Hi. Thank you so much.
Oh, sorry.
So you get these kits and you assemble it yourself.
That's cool.
You can either buy the baffle from them or you can actually make your own if you want, but that's kind of crazy. Now let's see if we can get to play it.
Track, which is also ours. Both of them have the same kind of modular approach to it.
Okay, one thing at a time. Let's talk about this chair. So you build it as a kit?
Yeah, it comes disassembled and you assemble it yourself.
And how much does that cost?
We don't have an official price yet. I assume it's going to be somewhere between $2,500 and $3,300.
Oh, okay. I like it a lot. Do you like that chair? Is it comfortable?
Yeah, it's nice. It's a nice chair. Nice space for the arm.
I'll give it what you want, what you want, what you want. Do I hear 21, 21, 21? I'll give it 21, 21.
I don't know, maybe the 90s or something like that. But I wrote an entire four-part discography dissection of YMO that almost no one read, but I think it turned out quite good.
That was on my former endeavor?
Yeah, that was on your previous endeavor.
Analog Planet. But he will be writing for TrackingAngle.com.
Yeah, yeah. And there's more stuff related to this I can write about for TrackingAngle. We've discussed that.
Of course, and no one will read it there too, but I'm happy to publish it.
it'll be there for when people do all the Google
finally
searching.
Finally catch up to you. When they finally catch up to you,
yeah, exactly.
It'll be there.
Yeah.
That's the important thing.
So, yeah, this is probably their best record. Yellow Magic Orchestra was Hiromi Hosono, Yukihiro Takahashi, and Ryuichi Sakamoto. Sakamoto is probably best known in the U.S. for his soundtrack work. He's done a lot of soundtracks for things. But Hiromi Hosono was the guy who basically had the original idea for YMO. Basically, the original idea was to kind of poke fun at Western exotica tropes from a Japanese perspective. But then it sort of evolved into this when they did a lot more artsier stuff, and they were at the beginning of synth pop. So a lot of this stuff is, you know, early synth pop and very pioneering. In fact, like the record before this, BGM, comes with a list of all the equipment they brought on tour with them. And it's about 700,000 modern US dollars worth of equipment. And it was also known for breaking down in the middle of a show because it would overheat. So yeah, this is probably their best record, easily their best record. Let me correct myself. I'm going to put on some stuff from side two. This is also pressed on JVC Super Vinyl that JVC in Japan had developed. It's sort of a slightly translucent brown when you hold it up to light. That's what the old MoFis were pressed on, but then they had to stop using it because they found that it was giving people cancer.
So what?
I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if we find the same thing with all the new formulations that they're coming up with. I mean, you know, it's something where it takes time to
hopefully they check into that stuff now. I would hope.
We can only hope. Yeah, the original Japanese pressings of the YMO catalog are really the only way to listen to it, because a few years ago they put out a set of remasters that Bob Ludwig did, that Bernie Grumman cut to vinyl, but Bob Ludwig did the digital remasters, and they suck. They're all compressed and blah and unlistenable. Original pressings are the way to go.
What the analog bridge is, essentially, is a very advanced buffer, a well-designed buffer. Very low distortion, very wide bandwidth, 0.003%, 1 dB down at 200K, minus 105 dB noise floor. Okay, I preface that, this is not a flavor box we're out of,
right? That's what I wanted to add.
Okay.
So what is it, what's the purpose of it?
The purpose of it is to add to character to a solid-state system.
Okay.
You know, we've modified solid-state gear in half for years. This is the mod outside of the DAC or player. Digital gear comes and goes, but the bridge, you can plug it into anything and have that tube sound in your system.
One product at a time.
Correct.
So between your DAC and your preamp.
It looks like two sources, so it could be solid-state mono, solid-state DAC, or two DAC, DAC player, whatever.
Oh, so there's a switch on it to go between two sources.
Yes. It'll, two inputs. Also two different tube families. So this is 6922, 6SN7.
Oh.
Both circuits fully operational. So on the fly, you can go one tube family to another.
You can hear the difference there immediately.
Yeah. And it's tube rectified, so you get a third variable you can change, right?
And how much does that cost?
$2,900.
How much?
$2,900. Okay. That's an add cost for balanced, which is Lundorl transformer coupled in to out to create a fully balanced output.
Okay.
And this is a prototype, but I think I'm going to add this function to it, which is to have a pass-through. So I'll show you how we do that.
So that you can take it out of the system
yeah.
here. With, oh, that's a good
so
idea.
It's real simple. This is $6,922. And this is the buffer in, and I'm gonna switch it. Now there's no tubes, okay. Just the mic test, right?
Interesting.
You get the two three-dimensionality, you get the two body sound.
Sure, sure.
But you're not adding tons of tube distortion and noise,
right?
You're not losing any bandwidth.
Right.
So that's where I differentiate this from buffer, right? So like the digital bridge for a different digital company, this is our analog bridge. That's the kind of marketing
yeah.
angle I'm working on.
Cool.
Okay?
So Michael Levy designs the Alto audio speakers, and I want to interview you just for a minute because you've gotten a lot of buzz. You know, the speaker business is so, there's so many speakers out there. Somehow you've managed to get a lot of good press and good buzz. And why did that happen?
I think it's the reason behind that. It's because I'm opening up a completely different view of what design should be. The story that I tell very often is how I had decided to be a loudspeaker designer from when I was a child. And I was in NYU when Neville Teal and Richard Small came out with their original papers on tuning loudspeakers. And I had two questions for them on it. What was a tuned board speaker? What happens to a woofer below resonance? And their answer was it decouples, which meant it moved without creating sound, creating Doppler distortion and wasting energy. I said, that's not good. My second question was, you stuff the cabinet with padding in order to remove standing wave resonances, and you put a single factor in the equations for loss. I said, but it's not a linear loss, and it's not a single factor. And Richard Small said to me, how long did you want the paper to be? And I said, long enough to design a speaker properly. And when I went through my research through the years, I discovered that number one, you have to look at the history of how instruments are designed to understand how a speaker should properly be designed. Now, instruments were designed from the point of view of what sounds best. They didn't have equations to work out. And when you look at a stand-up bass, you look up any, it's very similar to a speaker. The driver is the strings, and the resonant cavity is there. The tonality is something else where they use the surface for, but the internal resonance has to be smooth through a very wide band. So you'll never find an instrument that's shaped like a box. And it's the easiest thing to build. There's a reason why people in the past didn't do that. It sounds better when you shape the cabinet to reinforce all frequencies equally. The second thing is, I never heard of anybody putting padding in their Stradivarius to make it sound better. I mean, that's ridiculous, isn't it?
That was Heifetz's secret. You didn't know that?
So the point is, why would you want to do that to a speaker? It kills dynamics, it loses inner detail. So the design of the speakers internally includes my XTL transmission line, which is a hybrid between tune port and transmission line, and couples the woofer right through resonance to infrasonics, and you can feel the bass go through the floor, there's no boominess, everything is controlled. Second thing is, the shaping of the cabinet makes all frequencies get reinforced equally, so therefore we can pull the padding right out, and we get a much more linear response.
So there's no padding in it whatsoever?
At all. There are some damper pads at edges to prevent standing resonances, but all the sound travels through pure air. Nothing
and if
else.
You bang on the side of the box, is it?
You'll hurt your knuckles. It's about all you're going to get.
What is the box made out of?
It's made out of what we call damp hard, and the material is MDF, HDF, acrylic damping material trapped in between in multiple layers so that it is hard on the outside so that sound bounces off of it well, but it is internally dead to all frequencies. You will not hear it resonating at all.
Yeah. And So for the people that are only listening to it and not knowing any of that stuff, they go in and they listen to it, they like what they hear, and they're not that expensive, really. So the floor standing ones that are in this room are how much?
They're $18,000 a pair in the Lexus silver finish that you're looking at. They're actually $17,000 in piano black, which is a gorgeous piano black, and we have them in rosewood that is to die for, and a beechwood that is beautiful for lighter wood.
Great. And you're doing well. You're selling a lot of speakers.
I'm getting back ordered.
Excellent. Great, Michael. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
To see my father and all my loved ones gone on.
So we're here, we're playing back via the Lumen Key 1 that you see here, and that is playing high-res music via Tidal and also from a hard drive into the Legacy Audio Wavelet 2 system. This is the latest Legacy Audio Wavelet 2 with our 64-bit internal bit-depth environment, as well as the new Legacy Audio Room Correction.
Okay.
We're utilizing this Hagel amplifier to power the top section of the Legacy Audio Aeris speakers that you see here. They feature 1,000 watts of internal amplification for the subwoofer, so the user provides a stereo amplifier for the top section.
Okay.
And we're controlling everything via this app here that's included with the Legacy Audio Aeris.
Cool. So what do these speakers cost?
Mm-hmm. So the Aeris are around $22,000 for the pair.
With powered mm-hmm. woofers.
That comes with the powered woofers
and
inside.
And the DSP correction.
Uh-huh. The DSP correction to add is another $7,450.
All right. Oh, great.
So, Michael, what we have here are the Magico S5 MK2s. We have the Constellation Centaur 2 500 stereo amplifier sitting on a crystal stand. Over here, we have the Constellation reference deck. On top is the MSB transport with output and power supply. And on top of the rack is Heiko Extreme Audio Server. And powering it all is the 2500 strong head. Feeding us on battery off the whole telephone.
Good idea to get off the grid here for sure. Right?
Get off the grid, exactly. And the cable, a lot of the cable here is AudioFest Mythical Creatures Dragon. A lot of the cable as well. We're real of the great believers in AudioFest.
This is the newest version of your panel, and this is a panel that you connect up to a monster cable, wrong word, a giant cable, and that's like 220 volts?
It supports 220, 240, but it's right now, we're always wired in single phase.
Okay.
It is our new panel, and right now the real changes that we made here is we're using 8-gauge shielded conductor inside, all at the same length, and also the shield drains to ground. The bus bar is still the same, silver clad copper. The ground is still silver clad copper. And of course, the neutral is silver clad copper as well, using industrial size Eaton breakers. And of course, in the back, we have the receptacles where you plug in your gear in the mirror. You can see the receptacles there where all your gear plugs in. And the idea is to remove needs of secondary devices, of conditioners and fancy power cables, and just get power direct. This is designed for low impedance, massive current. We like to go all the way back as far as we can get, starting at the transformer on the pole.
Yep.
Yeah, the further you go back, the better your sound is going to be. Because always, too, you're facing the fact of noisy neighbors. And when we redid our panels in our facility, we had noisy neighbors. So I fixed all of our people around these power as well, just to get the utmost in performance.
Okay. So what does this cost?
Right now, so this is for $12,000. We're actually giving the panel and the consulting fee, working with the customer's electrician. Sorry about that.
Okay.
The customer electrician is probably about $3,000 to $5,000, but it doesn't just focus on audio, it focuses on the whole home. The idea is we're going to treat the home first, we're going to know the lows, we're going to know the phases, we're going to make sure the grounds are proper, and then we get into the audio side of it. So that way that starts the foundation and we continue it on into the audio room with something along this line.
So Mr. Rusty Trombone came to this show, took a room, and set up stuff just to entertain people, not to sell them anything. And that's laudable.
Well, thank you. What we want to do is meet fellow audiophiles.
Yes.
And we want to put the file in audio.
That's right.
Yeah.
And what we got here is a custom-made preamp that you built.
Fellow club member.
Oh. Yeah.
Tony the Wrench, the guide.
Tony the Wrench. And Rusty the Trombone. They got together in Brooklyn. And yep. They decided to do some business together, and it worked out pretty good. And then over here you got a Nakabichi. What is that?
That's a Dragon Transport from the late 80s, early 90s.
For cassettes?
No, for CDs.
For CDs? Oh.
It's got a little digital carousel changer in it. And then an Oppo 205 modified by Dan Wright.
Okay. And then over here you have a Sony
PSX-800. Linear tracking turntable with a Grace F9E Ruby cartridge.
That's a Grace F9E with Peter Letterman special cartridge with a Ruby cantilever. I've got one of those and it's a wonderful sounding. Yeah, it's good. And that's beautiful. And then you have a Constellation amplifier.
Yeah, that's on loan. We blew ours up.
Alright, and you're driving your custom-made speakers.
Yes, yeah.
I mean, this guy came here, he didn't bring like a pair of bookshelf speakers. He came here to play. And he also brought a ceiling. This is actually the Webb telescope. Okay, have fun. So show me what you got here.
All right, we're featuring the Kef Blade Metas, the final first debut of the JC1 Pluses. We had this great plan when we introduced him in 2020. We went to Meyer's place and then COVID hit. So this is the first public showing of our JC1 monoblocks using the JC2BP preamp, the JC3 Junior Phono preamp.
Which is budget priced, really.
Budget priced at $1,700. Yep. And then at the bottom, we've got the cord acting as the DAC for the Inuos Zenith.
Okay.
And then Lenny and John Durda from MoFi lent us the Dr. Feikert Woodpecker. And Lenny brought the Schick arm and the MoFi Ultra Gold cartridge up and mounted that on Thursday. And then it's all wired with straight wire with an AudioQuest Niagara 5000 providing the clean power for us.
Excellent. Thank you. And you are?
Phil with Parasound.
Phil with Parasound. Yes. Your last name happens to
Jackson.
Be with Parasound.
Yep.
Fantastic.
Phil with Parasound. Okay. Phil Jackson.
Thank you, Phil.
Thank you.
top of the line Phasmation phono stage. Hold on.
That's brand new.
Yeah, the 1200.
And what does that cost?
20,000.
How much?
20.
20K, okay.
Yeah. Left channel, right channel, power supply, tube rectification of the power supply, three tubes on each side there, and that's a Phasmation 2000.
And what does that cartridge cost?
7,000.
Is that the one I reviewed?
Yeah.
Oh, good. I forgot. I forgot the model number.
Hey, welcome. 1 minute still point stand.
Yeah.
Apertures and tube traps. And this is a Korean amplifier that I'm not that familiar with. It's a carriage drive amplifier. It's 25 watts per channel.
Oh.
Okay. And which is more than enough power to drive the Avant Garde with 104 dB efficiency.
So the total cost of this system is about what?
25,
32, 40, 60. Oh,
about 135.
Yeah. Sound any good? Say that louder for the camera.
It sounds a wunderbar.
How much is it?
About $125,000 with all the cables and everything else.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
And it sounds good.